Okay, so when you finished on the 6000 grit with the slurry on, okay, we finished on that. You want to get a nice clean sponge or cloth and just wipe that slurry off nice and clean. You want to wipe your knife off, okay, and we want to add some water.
So the stone's still wet, it's just clean.
Yeah, got to be wet, yeah, and just clean it up. So we take all that slurry off. Okay, that'll do you. And then we do the whole thing again, all right? So, but we do the whole thing again. So again, we run the knife up and down. And this is the final work. Up, it's still taking off metal, but it's just taking off finer particles of metal. It's just the final little polish up. This is very important. If you want a very sharp knife, all the stages lead to this point. Now this is only a 6000 grit stone. You can get 10,000 grit stones. I don't have one. One day I'll get one, but I don't have one at the moment.
Mind you, your knives are sharp enough, really, for what you're carving.
Yeah, yeah.
Because you sort of specialise in silver birch, don't you?
Silver birch. I usually use silver birch. What I've got here is I've got a range of knives that will cut from silver birch right the way through to laburnum.
Right.
My favourite silver birch knife will fold immediately, you know, just looking at laburnum. It'll just fold up.
And that's it. I mean, they're basically the same shape of blade, aren't they? Just pan down your knives.
Yeah.
But they're different steel mixes, aren't they?
Yeah. They're all Macris knives.
Yeah.
And we've got a 15N20, but this is my favourite. And that goes through silver birch like a laser.
It's
incredible. But if I show it anything harder, it'll fold up. But that's such a sharp knife.
Yeah.
It's beautiful. And we've got a 01 steel,
mm-hmm.
and that's kind of middle of the road.
Well, that's a pretty much blade that most people are going to know.
Yeah, most people will know that one.
Yeah.
and that'll do most things, but again, laburnum, it's fine, but we have something even better. We've got a silver steel.
Yeah.
And that gives Superman a fright.
Yeah, and I'm a big favourite of silver steel.
Yeah, that'll go through laburnum, no problem at all. But you get different feelings off of different steels. I like this because it's flexible. I like the 01 because it's honest.
Mm-hmm.
The silver steel is very good, but I get no feedback from it. It's a very good steel. It's sharp, super sharp. The edge lasts a long time, but I get no feedback.
Right.
There's no life to it. This laminate blade is very lively. They all act in different ways. They're all the same shape, but they all act differently. It's quite remarkable.
So you're clearly talking as somebody who uses a knife in his hand, you know, every single day. I've never heard anybody describe about getting feedback for a blade before.
Oh, okay. Yeah, well, I've carved most days. If I'm not out walking, and my other love is photography,
mm-hmm.
and you know, I'm also a bit of a bushcrafter, so I like to go out and make things and photograph things. But if I'm not doing that, then I'm carving or trying to work out a carving.
Or keep your website up to date.
That's right, keeping the website up to date, and or sharpening other people's tools, as I quite often get equipment sent to me in the post, and as long as it's not been butchered, and it can be sharpened by hand, then I'll take the job on.
Right.
I've got,
because that's something that obviously a lot of people may not be aware of. Obviously, I know obviously you are a wood carver.
Yeah.
But you obviously, because you use these knives, you do that
as a service. I sharpen the knives for a local delicatessen just down in Bobby Tracy, and some carvers send me knives to tickle up for them.
So people can contact you and obviously get your details and just post you a knife and then you'll sharpen it and return it?
Post it back to them, yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. I charge £10 an hour.
Mm-hmm.
And I can usually get most things sorted out within an hour.
Mm-hmm.
And if I can't do it, then I'll send it up to Scotland to my associate, Chris Grant, and he'll sort it out for you. But you know, if it's too badly done,
mm-hmm.
Right, this is coming along beautifully now. It's nice. Yeah, how's that? Let's see how sharp that is now. You kind of get lost in this sharpening business as well. I'm talking to you and sharpening it. I'm just feeling. I'm not even thinking about what I'm doing. I'm just sort of feeling it. Okay. Well, we get a bit of paper and we'll see. See if that's any good. Yeah, that's not too bad. Yeah, okay. Right, well, what else I like to do, I mean, that's sharp enough. I'll go and get an old belt.
So, what I just want to show on the camera is what a lot of people do when they're talking about their knives being sharp is they get the knife, I'm trying to see if you can actually see that I'm going to do, they get their knife and they draw the, it's not wet, and they draw the knife through the paper, okay, and you talk about how sharp their knife is. When knives are properly sharp, what you should be able to do is hold the paper and draw the paper through the knife, okay? Now, I didn't have to draw that, that's not following on inspiration, that's literally just pulling the paper, look, through the blade. Now, I don't need to shave my hand with these knives because I know these are razor sharp. it's something I'd say, you know, try with your knives at home, get your knife sharp and try that test on a piece of paper.
Excellent, well done, that's brilliant. And you held it to me in the right way as well.
That's something else we should talk about, actually.
Yeah, if you give somebody a knife, give it to them like that, and then you won't get cut.
the other thing as well is when they're going to let them take their hand away.
Yes, yes.
Don't you suddenly pull a knife off them. It's another thing I always do.
Well done, that's brilliant. Yeah. Well, what I do in the wilds when I'm out in the woods carving is I've got an old leather belt. My friend Ross gave me this. He's a bit fatter than this now, which is why I gave it to him. I've put a couple of holes one end and a bit of paracord. And I've left the belt buckle on. You can always pull that off. That doesn't make a lot of difference. And what I do, so if I can just move it back here, a bit of space. I hook.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, you all right?
Yep.
I hook one end over my foot. And I make sure that the whole contraption is as far away from anything nasty up here, any arteries, as I can. Finger through the end, pull it nice and taut, and just gently swipe it up and down. Now you can also hang this off a tree or a door handle or anything you like. And I'm just being very measured and very gentle. And all that's doing is that's taking the wire edge off of the very tip of the cutting edge.
What we can see from this angle here is actually John is past his knees, so he's not actually carving into his thigh, which from the other camera angle, it does actually look like you're carving up towards your thigh. But right. From here, you can clearly see you're well away from your arteries on your inside of your legs.
And I'm not going at it like a mad thing either.
No, it's controlled.
Just a gentle swipe, and that should be enough.
Okay. Should we start on the beard?
Start on the beard. Well, I was going to see if I can. That's.
You can see it. Yeah, clearly coming off, John.
Yeah, so I can show you with that.
Mm-hmm.
I'm quite happy.
Now, if I can get enough subscribers to actually send a donation through, we can get John to do that beard.
Yes.
I don't think they can afford it, John.
No. But that's pretty well how you do it.
Excellent.
There we are. And it's nicely polished. I don't know whether you can see. Nicely polished up, and it's even showing the lamination.
And it, well, you can see the reflection from the camera in it.
Yeah. And I'll show you this side, because that's the side with the maker's marking.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Yeah.
Yeah.
Excellent.
Cool. That's brilliant.